From Bartlett's Island, we look back toward the mouth of the First Herring Brook across the North River where the brook enters. And we see a section where we can find a lot of shellfish, lots of quahogs or hard-shelled clams, plenty of soft-shelled clams, some very nice mussel beds in this area. As we move towards the east or towards the right, away from the mouth of the First Herring Brook, we come to the Third Cliff, and where the land drops away off the end of Third Cliff, we move out onto the barrier beach, which is known as Rivermore, and behind which a good many salt marshes have been built since this barrier was formed. From the end of the barrier beach off the dunes, we come to the open water, and this is the mouth of the North River. At one time, before 1898, this was a closed section of the river, and during a big storm in February of that year, that section was opened up, created the mouth of the river itself. As you go across this broad mouth, which has some of the worst currents in this particular area, we come to Fourth Cliff, and we no longer find ourselves in the North River. We're now in the South River, and it was 3 miles further on from this point to the south that the old opening was closed when this particular opening, North River, was created. Before we begin to move inland from the mouth of the river, it might be a good idea to take the time to look around and get a feeling of how broad and wide open and flat this area where we are happens to be. It's a good idea also to take a good look at the plants. Notice that they're all salt marsh plants, the spartinas, the spike grass, the juncus that we've talked about before. Because soon after we begin to move up the river and go by the remains of the old railroad bed that used to run across these marshes and have passed under the bridge at Route 3A, things are going to change rather dramatically. One of the first and most obvious things we're going to notice is how the headlands or the uplands seem to move in rather closely, and for the first time we're apt to have the feeling that we're actually in a river valley. From this point on, the freshwater plants become more prevalent in the marshes. The spartinas are still there, but the cattails and phragmites are beginning to creep out onto the flats. We even see signs of some cedars, which before the breakthrough of 1898 were alive and healthy. The influx of salt water proved too much. The trees died, and all that remains today are the standing trunks. In the vicinity of Route 3, the valley broadens a bit, and the tendency of water to travel along a curved path is illustrated by the meandering of the river in this area. At the upper end of the valley will be found the last historic site of the shipyards which once dotted the banks of the North River. For some time now, all signs have been those of a freshwater river. The vegetation along the banks and in the marshes has increased in diversity and is composed primarily of plants which are found only in freshwater environments. The river's always been rich in wildlife, not only plants, but animals, birds of all sorts, freshwater fish, and saltwater fish, like salmon and alewives, which run up the river to spawn. The North River is a main runoff for a large watershed and is fed by lakes, ponds, and streams from numerous towns in the area. Native Americans used the river as a source of food and as an important waterway for trade and travel throughout an area which extended to the Narragansett region.
We know that the river was used as a center of human activity. The task before us is to find evidence of that. Again, Dr. Hoffman.
The Survey and Planning Committee will actually plan the field work of the survey, and let me state right here for those of you who may be environmentally concerned that we intend to go very lightly on the land. I'm talking about 1 by 1 meter trenches at maybe 100 meter intervals. But that's a very light sampling design, as we would say. The purpose is, especially for the first 2 years, to get an idea of where the resources might be located. We know where a lot of sites are in the North River, but those sites have been collected with a certain bias. That is, they have been looked at in terms of where people expect to find them. And we expect that there are many sites where people have not looked because they have not expected to find them. Most of the sites we know of are on the main stem of the river. There have got to be sites back out from the main stem, special activity sites and the like. The Education Liaison Committee is a very important committee. We hope to educate an entire generation of school children in the value of cultural resource management. And to do this, we are going to engage in teacher training. We already have a course that is run at the South Shore Natural Science Center in the Archaeology of New England.
Again, David Magnuson.
The Science Center offers a wide variety of programs. It's staffed by a permanent staff of 13. It has a professional staff that is local experts of about 25. And amazingly, it has a volunteer staff of over 100 people who help administer these programs. The program is designed to offer programming to people of all ages. They have preschool programs. They have programs for older kids, both at the school and at the center. They have programs for young adults and adult education programs. Some of these adult education programs are, in fact, college level credit. The programming itself tends to focus on the North River. It consists primarily of biology, zoology, botany, geology, and most recently, archaeology.
Bridgewater State College is the central headquarters for the project. Scientific and educational studies relevant to the river and surrounding towns are already in progress. Twelve to 14,000 years ago, the last glacier melted back from what is now the North River Valley. The hills on either side are the remains of large deposits of sand, gravel, rock, and clay. The sedimentological studies of these deposits can aid in understanding the changes in the landforms from the time of the glaciers to the present. Those studies will ultimately help us to understand how landscape changes have influenced human activity. Bridgewater's in-service educational program is coordinated by Dr. Raymond Hopper.
School improvements come about in two ways. One, when teachers decide to engage in professional development for their own individual improvement by enrolling in courses on college campuses and by acquiring advanced degrees. And two, by staff development, when school systems, through the long-range planning, decide how they're going to improve their schools and involve their teachers in those improvements. So the purpose of staff development is school improvement, whereas the purpose of professional development is individual improvement. For example, this past fall at the South Shore Natural Science Center, Dr. Curtis Hoffman worked with school people to collaboratively design a course on New England archaeology. The best improvements for the future will come through such collaborative endeavors. The teachers of the first decade and the first of the 21st century are in the classrooms now. The changes that they make through professional development and through staff development will reflect the quality of the schools in that 21st century. Those teachers deserve and need our support.
And so the story begins, a 20-year study on the entire expanse of the North River watershed, embracing the talents of archaeologists, underwater researchers, geologists, geographers, ecologists, folklorists, historians, and members of the local communities, all working together to gain a richer understanding of the land, themselves, and those who went before.